Castanera Music Awards.
Oh, great.
So we're pretty excited.
Yeah. Someday he'll hit the big time. And then you'll have, in order to see your son, you'll have to go to Las Vegas or something like that. Is it that kind of music that would cross over to being popular?
Yeah, it's hard to say.
Okay.
He's got a little bit of something for everybody, I think.
Okay. Here comes Ela.
He wouldn't put us on the guest list, though, I can guarantee you. He's just like everybody else.
Yeah. Good evening. Is it today?
No.
Oh, tomorrow? It has to be, doesn't it?
What's today?
17th.
19th.
Oh, okay. Saturday. All right, each time we look at each horoscope, we try to look at some kind of classic. Something that we can learn about life or some division of life at the same time that we're looking at an individual. And in this case, this is a very good horoscope to study a mystic. And so we're going to spend most of the evening talking about mysticism. And the first thing we have to do is talk about the word mystic. And there are two definitions for the word mystic as we're going to be using it. One is a general definition and one is a specific definition. The general definition of a mystic is someone whose view of life is from within, that the truth of things is within, and one depends on intuition rather than on something outer, like empiricism or something like that. The within that general division of mystics, there are two subtypes. And those two subtypes are occultists and mystics. Only the mystic in this case is the specific definition. Occultists are people who approach the inner life or the spiritual life following the mind more than the emotions or feelings. They are head people rather than heart people. Mystics, in the specific definition, are just the opposite. They are people who follow their emotions and feelings. They are heart people. Now, this is not just a verbal distinction. It is a basic characteristic of the being throughout all of their rebirths. It's not just a distinction for one lifetime, even though one lifetime may have a more mystic stamp or a more occult stamp to it. In fact, in the inner physiology of a person, it's very different. Because when the energy passes from the lower creative center, which is associated with the genitals and the sacrum, to the higher creative center, which is associated with the voice box and the brain, the path is different for a mystic than for an occultist. There's a different channel in the spine. And even the order of the organs through which the spinal fire passes is different. In occultists, or occultists, the energy passes through the brain, straight up the spine into the brain, and it returns through the heart. But in mystics, it passes through the heart before going to the brain, the crossover spot being the larynx. Now, mystics and occultists are very highly developed people. They are the cream of two different types of humanity. And unfortunately, those two types of humanity are called Freemasons which are associated with occultism, and Catholics, which are associated with mysticism. But it's usually not a good idea to use those terms, because those terms have all kinds of connotations beyond what is intended by them in the way we're using them or the way we would think of using them. The better way of looking at it is to call them people of works rather than people of faith. Again, neither is exclusive of the other, but some people tend more toward faith, some people tend more toward works. But this also is controversial, because if you read the New Testament of the Bible, there are a lot of struggles between the different disciples when they're writing their epistles or their histories, between whether, you know, one will say faith without works is an empty faith, and another will say that works without faith are all vanity, and so there are those kinds of struggles also. So, back at our simple definition, mystics feel, and they live for and by feeling. Now, when we use the word feeling, we mean the taking in of something. So feeling is a form of receiving or accepting or of drawing in to one's being, and that can happen on various different levels. And it does happen on various different levels, and they all parallel each other. First of all, there is physical sensation, the sense of touch, which some people call the sense of feeling. And it is the most generalized of all of our senses. It's the only one that covers our entire body. Now, we talked about Helen Keller about this when we talked about the physical personality. We noted that she was capable of phenomenal things using the sense of touch, such as being able to determine color and things like that. And this is found quite frequently among blind people. Then there is feeling on the level of the desire world. Whether one emotes or one is receiving emotions, or whether one is asserting or drawing in, all emotion and desire must be preceded by a feeling. A feeling is what activates emotion or desire, or keeps it from being activated. So, even physical sensation or feeling, whether it is refined like Helen Keller's or whether it's dull, is not really felt in the dense physical body. There are receptors there, and there are nerves that carry it, and it feels like it's in the dense physical body, but it is actually in the desire body where it is felt. But it isn't the desire body that does the feeling, it is the spirit that uses the desire body as its vehicle of feeling. It's quite an intricate organism that we live in. So when we're talking about feeling in the desire world, it's not limited to the recognition of pain as it occurs in the physical body. Anguish and psychological pain are also felt in the desire body. So when we say something like, his feelings were hurt, we're talking about an experience in the desire body. It's an experience where a person is attached to certain kinds of emotions, and those emotions are thwarted. Then there is a much deeper kind of feeling, which occurs in life spirit. Now, very, very, very few people have experiences, conscious waking experiences in life spirit. In the West, they're called Christ conscious experiences. In Hinduism, they're called nirval kalpa samadhi. In Buddhism, or at least in Zen Buddhism, they're called satori. Now, almost everyone has had minor experiences of life spirit. That is when we have an intuition that we absolutely know that something is true, or something that has a feeling of truth about it, or a recognition when the lights go on. Those lights go on in life spirit. So we're going to speak of this level with Helen Keller a little bit further on. Now, it's safe to say that on all three levels or all three varieties of feeling, Helen Keller was very well developed. In fact, you might say, if you were to say anything about this life as a whole in one sentence, you might say that this was a life to experience and learn feeling. If one really thinks about it, it must be an extreme handicap to be both deaf and blind simultaneously. So let's try to imagine that in order to get at the kind of feeling and how it affects the individuality of Helen Keller. Now, most of us take vision for granted. Very few remember in infancy when we had to learn depth perception and focus and all of the other things that we have as skills in vision. And the same applies to hearing. But unless we, not so much with hearing though, because it seems to be a less illusory sense, but it's nonetheless, we had to learn how to use it. Now, unless we learn how to sketch or draw, or unless we learn a musical instrument or have some kind of work that requires us to improve our senses, most of us do not improve our senses during life. We take them for granted. We think we perceive, and we actually do perceive, but we quit progressing in it. We even quit progressing in the discrimination of what our perceptions actually see. The same is true with hearing. We can hear, but we often do not listen. Hearing, again, is a special case, or maybe vision is the special case because we can close our eyes, but all of the other senses we can't close off except as an act of consciousness. The sense of touch or the sense of feeling also cannot be shut off. And it doesn't decrease with satiation. For example, the sense of smell or the sense of taste do weaken as they are used. This is sort of nature's way of keeping us from overeating, because things don't taste well after a few minutes as much as they did in the first place. Therefore, all you people who save the dessert to the end, because you want to, you're saving yourself the best for the last, you're making a big mistake. You got to eat the dessert first if you want the good flavor. Do you eat the dessert first?
A lot of times.
Oh, yeah, my goodness. Jeez. Do you do it for that reason?
Pretty much.
Okay. When somebody touches us, it gets our attention. It wakes us up. In fact, if we're sensitive to touch at all, we don't even like to be in crowds because we're waked up to too many things that we don't want to be waked up to. When we have waking self-consciousness associated with sensation, in fact, we say even our waking consciousness is due to sensation. It's right in our language. We say he came to his senses rather than being withdrawn and in some kind of an inner world. Now, Helen Keller couldn't close her eyes because they were permanently closed for her. And the same thing is true for hearing. Now, vision and hearing are called the royal senses, or they're called the higher senses, and they're called the senses at a distance. Because to touch something, you have to be contiguous with it. To smell something, you have to be near, unless it's one of those factory farms that you can smell for miles. And to taste something, you have to touch it. But all of the great refinements that there are in human culture come from the higher senses. Music and art and all of those edifying kinds of activities are associated with seeing and with hearing. They're impersonal because they are removed. They get things that are away from the physical body. So we can see that in her loss of sensation, her removal was much more than a removal from objects of sensation. She was shut off from conversation with everything that makes human culture good. All of the non-biological things of humans, the abstract and the higher things. If she wanted to have these things, and when she was a child, she didn't know they even existed, and she didn't even want them because she didn't know that. But if she wanted these things, she had to reach out for them. She had to touch and she had to feel. Now, she did that quite admirably, and she worked very hard at it. And ironically, she worked at it indirectly. So what she was doing in the sense of the sun in Cancer is that she was sensitive like a clam. Only she had to open herself and keep herself open if she wanted to have any intercourse with the world at all. So she was constantly having to give her attention to perception and feeling. She could never take it for granted, because anytime she would take it for granted, she would be alone in the darkness and in the silence, and she would be in the eighth house, which is one of those retreat houses. Astrologically, when we look at her situation, it is more than just having to expose her very great Cancerian sensitivity to the world and being withdrawn in the eighth house. She had no direct vehicle for self-expression. Leo, which is ruled by the sun, is intercepted. So she didn't have an easily accessible outlet for that. So it gives us a time to pause and think about ourselves and realize that though we may be sighted and have hearing, we might ourselves still be in a cave. And that we, in our taking our senses for granted, it means that we're putting ourselves to sleep. It's not as dramatic as her case. Her case was obviously meant to be an exclamation point life about what this means to be able to be sensate. But we may be doing the same thing. In fact, I'm almost certain of it, because from time to time, when I have the time, I try to teach myself how to sketch or how to draw. And when I do that, I realize that most of the time I'm not really looking. And when I do look in drawing, I see things that were there all along, but I don't take note of them. And I don't appreciate them. And so that if I sit down and draw for 2 or 3 hours and then look at the world otherwise, everything looks beautiful. And I see things that I wasn't seeing that were there all along. So really we are in a place not too dissimilar from Helen Keller. Now, we know she had this remarkable sense of touch. We don't know whether that was innate by something of heredity, or whether she developed it in the exigency of her situation. I suspect that some of both. And the reason I suspect that a lot of it has to do with intentional development is because the number of blind people who can sense color and do things like that is much higher than you would expect with random genetic culling out of people. In any case, when your primary activity in life, or your only activity in life, is to put forth or to exert an effort to look at the external world, that shapes your character. And what we're talking about here, even speaking from a non-mystical point of view, we might say that this is somebody who was born to be an intentional feeler, which is what a mystic is. It is almost, and we're going to come to this more later on, it's almost as if she got off track as a mystic and needed this life to put her back on track by becoming an intentional feeler. Now, this worked in at least two ways. First, she seems to have learned conscious receptivity. We've been talking about that all along. Most of us are receptive to some things and not to others. Some non-receptivity is due to incapacity. Some of it is due to lack of education. But a lot of our receptivity is a matter of egoistic, petty preference. We don't care about some things, so we don't want to be receptive to them. And in a way, we are voluntarily blinding ourselves all the time. Now, there are other ways or other things that we can be receptive to. If we don't like one thing, we can look at something else. Helen Keller didn't have that luxury. She had to reach out for absolutely anything that came her way. And to some extent, she even had to rely on what was put in front of her to experience. And so she becomes self-conscious as someone who reaches out and takes things into herself. So this is what her individuality was like. This is what it is. This is how one develops one's individuality in deaf blindness, or at least the way she did it. Now, the eighth house is sometimes called the house of opportunities for threshold consciousness. By threshold consciousness is meant the boundary between waking consciousness and the more unconscious parts of our being and of the cosmos. Now, the threshold consciousness between the conscious and the unconscious is not a one-way street. It's more like French doors in a busy restaurant. They swing both directions. Thus, for example, which I've been doing more of lately, consciously, if we want to change habits, or if we want to awaken ourselves to something, if we place a suggestion in our subconscious that such and such is going to be done. Now, like I've found that I've lapsed in praying and giving thanks for food. And I have now placed suggestions in my consciousness so that when it comes to eating, I remember certain actions take place in the process of eating, and then I remember, oops, you have to be thankful for this. In order to put something into the subconscious in that way, you have to go across the threshold. Or if you had that, the fourth house is the subconscious, or opportunities to be experiencing the subconscious. The 12th house are opportunities to experience the superconscious. So that if you have out-of-the-body experiences as an invisible helper or something like that, and you want to bring them back to this world, they also have to come across the threshold consciousness. You know, there's the threshold, for some people, the doors need oiling. They don't swing very well. And so that's what we're talking about here. So in this regard, Scorpio is the eighth sign that analogically relates to the eighth house. And the eighth, this is why the eighth house, the Scorpio has always been the gateway between life and death, or birth and death. So we can see that she became a self-conscious, intentional feeler, and she became actively receptive, reaching out to participate and do as many things as she could. Now, all of this activity that we're talking about is reinforced by having all those planets in the Western Hemisphere. The Western Hemisphere shows receptivity, but it shows another part of the way that she developed her individuality, because the Western Hemisphere also shows responsiveness. It's not merely enough to be receptive. You can be receptive and you can be like some sink that everything comes into you, but the purpose is not to take more and more experience in it. The purpose is to interact with the world. Because in the spirit-matter interchange is where all of our consciousness grows. It doesn't grow from just getting more and more information. So responsiveness is the counterpart, you might say, to receptivity. So receptivity is one side of the equation, and responsiveness is the other. So she got beyond being merely a passive receiver, and she became a active responder. Now, because of the planets in the West, and because of the severe disability, she can't really assert herself. She can't initiate. She might like to. She's got all those planets in fire signs. They like to initiate things, and she's got a healthy amount in cardinal signs, so she might like to initiate. But she can't. All she can do is respond when she has received things that have been initiated by others. So this seems then like in this life, she's passing from a state of consciousness that was probably more aggressive, because the ruler of the ascendant is also the ruler of the 12th house, and that usually means a direct carryover from the immediate past life. And that ruler or co-ruler is Mars. So she, in the past, she probably was aggressive, and given a chance in this life, she would have been aggressive. Before her education began, she was aggressive like a little animal running around and nothing could be done with her. She even fought with her teacher in her life, and so she did have a lot of that martial type of quality, and so the receptivity and responsiveness was necessary to keep her from going too far to in the extreme. Now, if you think about it, if you're put in a position that you have to be receptive and responsive, that's humbling. The sun in Cancer is humble. Mystics are humble people. Now, this is another testimony that this is a horoscope of a humble mystic. Now, we know that mystics feel, and it's clear, that there is a life to be felt. The second thing that is mystical that's developed in this individuality is by being placed in a condition of vulnerability is faith. if you got all your senses about you, and if you're a strong, assertive, aggressive type of person, you know, your faith is in your muscles. But if every factor in your life is in the hands of someone else, you have to have faith in people to begin with. And so you'll learn a whole stance about life that is a stance of faith. And so she began to develop faith in this life by receiving rewards. When she was little, she remembers it. It was a watery sign experience. We've talked about it before. When she was little, Anne Sullivan grabbed her and put water in her hand, and then in her other hand scratched the palm for the sign language for water, and it took a few instances, and she got it. She knew that there was a name for that experience, and that was a tremendous, that was a mystical experience for her, because it opened her up to the whole world of education. It opened her up to the whole world that included other people and what other people did. But in the early stages of her education, she had to have rewards. Once she started opening up, then culture and spirituality followed after that. When she understood that there was a connection between everything and everything worked together, that was her opening. Now, she was, in her spirituality, she was a Swedenborgian. And Emanuel Swedenborg was an 18th century mining geologist in Sweden. And one day, out of the blue, he opens up full clairvoyance. And he's astounded by it. And all the rest of the life, I have all of his spiritual books in the other building in a private library there, which on rare occasions I'll lend out. All the rest of his life, he spends writing and talking about what he sees in the spiritual worlds and the meaning that it has. He was not an initiate into the mysteries, but he sure knew a lot of the mysteries, and it's very refreshing. Yeah, he wrote with a tedious language, but it's very refreshing to read him because it isn't in the same language that everybody else wrote in. And so what he wrote was really beautiful. If you're interested in the scuttlebutt or the gossip, Rudolf Steiner claims that Emanuel Swedenborg was Ignatius Loyola in his previous life, the founder of the Jesuit order. And the Jesuits, when they start their discipline, and it's a harsh discipline that the Jesuits go through, are given a little book called The Spiritual Exercises. And he was faithful in doing those exercises, and they in fact did unfold a kind of clairvoyance, but it wasn't an initiate clairvoyance because the exercises were not based on the spiritual principles of the universe. So that they would be an initiate kind of series of exercises. But at any rate, Helen Keller was a Swedenborgian because what she experienced inside of herself was more like what Swedenborg wrote of. Now, there's a wonderful movie. It's a documentary, and it's by one of the best filmmakers that I think that has ever been. His name is Werner Herzog, and this whole movie is interviews or talking about the life of people who are deaf and blind. And it's he takes you to strange places with it. I'm sure there must be a video of it out somewhere. But most of them, in fact, all of them, do hear things. And they do see things, but their hearing and seeing is a different kind of hearing and seeing than the things that we experience in this world. And so she became a Swedenborgian because what she experienced inwardly was like what he was talking about. So she wasn't far enough along Now we're going to try and be more refined in this, both in looking at it from her life and looking at it from the horoscope. She was, even though she was a mystic, it does not mean that she was really developed as a mystic. She made great strides in her faith, but she didn't unfold great visions, and she didn't have mystical powers or do miracles or anything like that, but she did live by faith, and she learned to live by faith. In fact, in some ways, she probably needed more discrimination in her faith because she had faith in things that were not to her benefit to have faith in. She could not have the works because she probably didn't have the soul power or wasn't that far along. We're going to come to that in a little bit. Even the mystics who do have the full capacity and who have all of their abilities find that relative to the things that really count spiritually, where the power comes from that miracles are from, or where the truth is that abides in visions that they have, is something that they can't do themselves. So again, we have this faithfulness and this humility that they of themselves can do nothing. Now, in this life, it was forced, but it is a good step in the direction of mysticism. Now let's go to the next level and look at feeling on the level of the desire world and the desire body. The region of feeling in the desire world and the desire body is called the central region. But that centrality is not a geometric centrality. It is a centrality in terms of importance. Space in the desire world doesn't at all mean what it means here. And if we try to look at it too much that way, we're missing the main thing about the desire world. It is central in importance because, as we just said a few minutes ago, if we do not feel something, we cannot emote. We cannot have a desire or a passion or anything like that. Now, the region of feeling is co-ruled by the moon and Cancer. So this tells us that at this second level of feeling, the feeling in the desire world, she's very much awake in this lifetime. Now, this was almost expectable because she couldn't have done these things that she did if the spirit was not awakening up and if it was not well focused, because sensation is not enough alone. She has to carry it at least as far as the desire body so that the spirit can know what the physical sensation is. It has to be carried into the realm of knowability. Now we can see that even though she may not have been advanced in the same way that St. Teresa of Avila was advanced as a mystic, she's not a complete beginner either. Because if we look at the aspecting and the positioning of the moon, the feeling that one gets is not, this is not a beginner. The moon is in Pisces, which indicates compassion, and it represents sensitivity in the feelings and refinement more toward the rare kinds of emotions rather than just gross emotions or personal passions of selfishness and things like that. But she was in a higher sense, she was well developed. She did like good literature, and she was not a crude human being. The sextile to Neptune by the moon indicates more of the same. It indicates a very good deal of refinement. Now, this is only one aspect to the moon, and it really isn't a strong aspect, but because of her condition and because of her focus, it must have been appreciable because she did have a refined sensitivity. This brings us to another astrological fact that we always need to repeat because it's important when you're doing astrological work, and that is there is a redundancy. And a redundancy always magnifies all members in the redundancy, the original and the following members. So we're finding something in the desire level that's parallel to the physical level. Beside feeling, there is yet another redundancy between the moon and the sun in Cancer, and that is imagery. Cancer, we know, is a pictorial sign. The moon is pictorial, and the moon put together with Neptune is very imaginative, but not necessarily pictorial. So she was capable of both kinds of imaginations, pictorial imaginations and the more indefinite kinds of imaginations that one sees in the inner worlds. So, technically speaking, this whole positioning of the moon indicates that she is probably well developed in what is called the region of impressionability in the desire world. And the region of impressionability in the desire world, the forces of attraction and repulsion are equal, so that when something is felt, it takes the impression and it separates that impression from other things by repulsion, and by attraction it holds it together, and thus imagaic forms are formed in the desire world or in the desire body. And this shows that she was probably well developed in that. Now, images are more complete experiences than just simple thought impulses. Whether an image is formed as a result of a memory of a sensory experience, or whether an image is formed around a creative impulse that comes from the spirit through the mind, when an image is formed, there is a completion. The thought is completed. The impression from the external world is completed in that it is given a form. And so that's a total kind of experience. So this is another kind of completion, in the same way that receptivity was completed by responsiveness. Through imagery is a completion of either thought activity or of memory activity. So we can say then that this is the kind of work that she was doing in this life, and it also shows her to be healthy in doing it, in that she just didn't sense something, she formed an impression about it. And when you have that impression, you can take the experience more fully. Now, some people who don't know about mysticism are aghast at the thought that thought image is a more complete thinking. And some people would be aghast at the idea that we say that she's a mystic, because she didn't talk that much about God. Well, she certainly confidently believed in it. She didn't do an excessive amount of praying or meditating, or at least her biographers don't talk about it, and she doesn't talk about it in her own biography. She didn't do a whole lot of scripture reading either. Some people would say, then how can you say that she is a mystic? A mystic does not have to follow some orthodox path of things. It can be very well self-styled, and if you're going to such great lengths that you have to be deaf and blind to accomplish your mysticism, that's a self-styled kind of mysticism. So when we think about the moon and Neptune, we have to say that probably, but not certainly, that her moon-Neptune images were more likely psychic images than they were spiritual images, because we have this same thing that's happening. We have something being taken from the external world and drawn inward to the consciousness, into the spiritual being. We have things growing from the emotional nature being drawn into the spirit through the sun. So we can see that this is not somebody who is taking direction from the spirit and projecting creativity. The flow, the direction of flow is more from the without to the within, whereas in most conventional forms of mysticism that are associated with religion and things like that, the flow comes more from the spirit and it passes into the world. So it comes from within out. Now, the moon is in the fourth house, which is another retreat house. And we just said earlier that the fourth house represents opportunities to be in touch with the personal subconscious. So most of what the personal subconscious is memory. Some people, like the Rosicrucian philosophy, calls it the subconscious memory. And then it has nothing else about it. Sometimes memories are, because they are brought together by analogous association, sometimes they become agglutinated or they become formations and they become complexes. Now, for a deafblind person, memory is much more important than for you and I. Disabled people rely on memory much more than non-disabled people. Suppose you're walking down the street and there's a something that blocks your way. Now, it's a permanent feature. Maybe it's a lamppost or something like that. A sighted person can see that and sidestep it. But if you're blind, you have to remember that it's there. We had an experience in Detroit about a year ago that we have a friend over there that is becoming deafblind. And the blindness is almost total now. There's still some hearing yet. And he was guiding somebody driving a car, saying, you go this many blocks and then you turn, and the person driving turned in the wrong place, and the deafblind person caught that he turned in the wrong place and told him how he had to correct. This was Eddie. Ed Simmons was directing Eddie, and he told him that, no, you just made a wrong turn there. So if you and I forget information, we can look it up. But a deafblind person can't do that. They have to retain it. Now, the reason we're looking at this study of the individuality and spirituality in this way is that there's another side to it. And that is, there is a transformative side to it. The sextile between the moon and Neptune is a second sextile, which means it is a synthetic sextile. So she is probing the personal subconscious, the memories and the other images that are there, and probably she's drawing on its primitive factors, and she's directing them to something spiritual or to something psychic, at least to some kind of impression. And this is, again, is another redundancy of taking from a lower state and bringing it to a higher state. Previously, we looked at tactile things being taken into self-consciousness, and now we're looking at memories being taken into at least desire body forms, if not higher. So in all cases, she's drawing on lower things and taking them to higher things. So now let's go back to the sun as the center of self or the center of individuality. And we see, because it is in Cancer, it's all bound up with feeling and emotion and desire in the desire body. Now, it's a mystical fact that if a person wants to know something through feeling, the experience must be complete through sensation, through desire body, and directly into the spirit. The sun in Cancer shows that she is self-consciously aware and intently focused in the desire body. She is aware of herself as a creature of feeling and desire. And in the eighth house, it's showing that she's sitting like right on the threshold between the inner worlds and the outer. In fact, it's only with great effort that she's focused into the outer worlds at all. So it's sort of like somebody like fishing, like ice fishing or something like that. You're in this upper world, and only you have a small connection with the world below you, and you're drawing things up out of that world. The sun is the self. It is a spiritual being. And it is through the sun that connection is made with the spiritual consciousness. Now, we've all said that before, but we've said that all before, but what we want to say now is that she identifies herself as a being who feels, as a being who responds, as a being who is capable of taking the world into her and having some kind of a spiritual understanding of it through impressions. So she knows herself pretty clearly in that way. She gives her attention. She herself was given a lot of attention. She was given even adulation for all of the things that she did because of her self-consciousness. But fortunately, she was humble enough to not be sucked in by that, because she had to spend so much attention just being aware of what was going on. She didn't have much more psychic or spiritual energy available to give it over to vanity. So it was a very healthy thing in her limitation. Now, this is the horoscope of a classic mystic in another way. The sun is in conjunction with Venus, and Venus is the planet of love. This means she identified herself as a being of love, someone who loves, and because she was so well taken care of, someone who is loved. She was not just some sensitive plant. She had that higher faculty, that quality of love that Shakespeare in Merchant of Venice raises us above the brutal things. So she was in charge of her life, and she was in cheery, positive spirit most of the time. She was not depressed as you would think a person would be, because if you know that you are loved, and if you know that you're capable of loving, that's like a special miracle. And so you're bound to be cheery with that being the case. So the combination of self, of the individuality and love and feeling, we can see then that this very much describes a mystic. Now, with this love, there was not an attachment to it. Because if there were an attachment to it, she would have been something like a sensualist. The sun in the eighth house means the loss of things, and it means the detachment of things. And so she had to not cling to things. Because of her disability, the eighth house is the behind the scenes house, she was forced to be behind the scenes. Now, the sun is a volitional planet, and it says that she actually prefers being behind the scenes, because there's sort of a special kind of Cancerian privacy that she has in her individuality. So this is not just from habit or acquired from necessity. This is volitional from the spirit. Now, obviously, all the experiences that she had are not out for the public. And she did not learn the language other than Swedenborgianism to put them out before the public. So there may have been more than we know about. Now, as we said earlier, the path of mysticism is the path of the heart. And this is another testimony to show that she was a mystic. She did things lovingly, she did things from the heart, and she did things volitionally. She knows the world through love. Be very different than if she had to be in some place where there was fighting going on all of the time, And she did have a very specialized environment, but you can't expect too much of a human being. There's only so much a human can do. And so she became a person who loved, a heart person. Now, the eighth house is the house of the hidden meanings of things. And the feeling of things is that she had, oops, you gotta be careful here. Boy, I'm messing around with all my notes. Oh well, we'll hope that they come out right. Let's look at mysticism in another way. The most blatant and obvious marker of Helen Keller as a mystic is the sun sextile to Uranus. And Uranus, when it functions as a higher octave, is the planet of mysticism. So let's do a little bit of aspect analysis on that aspect. We can see when we look at the structure of the aspect that the sun is the number four planet and it's pretty strong. Uranus is the number two planet. It's just a little bit stronger, but by percentage, it's only 1%. So it's two pretty strong planets, and the second strongest of all of the aspects. So what we have here is two strong foci of consciousness, both foci being foci of light. One being the spiritual light of the sun, and one being the light of life spirit. And there's a very strong tool between them. So there's an eager kind of expansion and interplay between the two of them. And because the aspect is very strong and the planets are strong, it means that the tool has more potential than she may ever be able to fulfill. That's what you get when you have that kind of a structural thing. So it's open-ended potential. When we look at the work of the aspect, some of the things that the sun does is itself. It is deliberate assertion of will or of selfness. And it is a kind of love light. And in her case, we see it as a spiritual feel. Uranus represents mystical experience. It represents awakening, represents altruism, and it represents direct apprehension of things. So what we're seeing here is intuitive self-knowledge. Despite all of the association with feeling on the two lower levels, the self-knowing is very much a matter of intuitive, direct self-knowing. And it is something of sudden, often deliberate self-awakening. And so the combination is a combination of divine love. All of these things put together describe a mystic. If we look at the quality of the planet, of the aspect, it's a benefic aspect. And it seems to signify that the things that she discovers or that she awakens to are likely to be truth, not likely to be erroneous. And it probably means that she benefits the things she discovers as much as the things she discovers benefits her. It's a sextile, so it is reflective. It is not like she's going to be hit by a stroke of lightning. That would be more like the sun conjoined Uranus. It's a sextile. And so it's likely to be expansive. This again, if we go back to what we talked about in the first place, the fact that the aspect is so strong, the expansiveness or the potential for growth in her mystical awakening is more than she possibly can ever overcome. But it's kind of nice to have the assurance that you can go further than as far as you want to go. Let's look at relative strengths. Let's take the cases that are not our case first in Uranus-Sun aspects. If Uranus is stronger, significantly stronger than the sun, it's ecstasy. It's like an overwhelming ecstasy. And in mystics, it is almost astoundingly humble. We don't have that case, nor do we have the other case where the sun is much stronger than Uranus. You may discover something about the world, but the thing is you discover more about yourself, and it's more important what you discover about yourself than what you discover about the world. This is really the knowing of self as a divinity. In the balanced case, which is our case, the wonder and the awe are appreciated and they are awakening, but the person isn't overwhelmed. And one understands oneself in the light of spiritual truths, but not in such a way that there is a self-importance that dominates over them. And there is, in the balanced sense, there's a sense of I'm doing things all right. Because we remember that Iranian intuition is not knowledgeable intuition, it's straightforward intuition that you know that something is true. And if you know that you are true, it means that when you're under the influence of the Uranus sun aspect and they're equal to each other, you have that silent kind of inner guidance saying, I'm doing everything all right. So everything is new and clear. But the clarity isn't, or the novelty isn't only in self and it isn't only in the world. It is like a rebirth discovery of it that takes place between the two. All right, signification, it occurs in negative signs, indicating that it must be introversive. And we've been seeing that all along. And this is another instance of something being receptive. It's in cardinal and common signs, meaning to say that this is not going to be like one enlightenment, that it's going to be like a lightning strikes and etches the stone, and it's going to be that way forever. It's saying that this person is likely to be adaptable. And it is in the adaptability that they get the life of the spiritual life. And it is in specific, it is in Cancer and Virgo. Now, if you've ever worked much with Cancer-Virgo combinations, you know that those are the cleanliness fetish signs. There are people that have to wash their hands 40 or 50 times a day or something like this. And what this seems to point to here, it points to like a dainty and impeccable kind of spirituality. This is not like a freight train spirituality. Now, these are also maternal signs. Cancer is Mother Nature. Everything lives in water. And the Divine Virgin is what is ruled by Virgo. So there is something here about seeking of a spiritual purity, a protective spiritual purity that is in this higher level of her mystical trait. If we look at the domification of it, it occurs in circumstantial houses. So she must accept the basic conditions and standards of reality. It happens in succedent and angular houses, which means that she has to deal with acute relationships and the responsibilities to them, but it indicates that she can reach her freedom through the basic structures and by being faithful to them. In the eighth house, in the tenth house, it is disassembling everything in life in order to attain some objective. The 10th house is the house of objectives, and the astrological energy is passing from the 8th toward the 10th. And so that's what it's like. I don't know what more to say. In terms of application, the aspect is separating, meaning to say that the big excitement is over. Whatever happened in the world is over, and now is the quiet denouement. And in terms of spiritual things, that's very important, because after the excitement is over is when the new creativity takes place. There is a threefold way that things happen in evolution. Things build in a slow way, and there's a lot of experience that is gained, and new things are developed. And then comes a period of sudden change, whether it is a war or whether it is a change of cycles in the evolutionary cycle, but there's a period of sudden change. And then after that, there is a quiescent period. And in that quiescent period is when the new species come out in physical evolution, or when the new attributes of the spirit come out in the grander spiritual evolution. So it's like saying that for her, after the excitement, any time the sun Uranus is stimulated, after the excitement is over, the insights that come in the aftermath are more important. This is, in the separation, it's something like if you listen to a tuning fork, you hear the sound, and it seems like you can follow that sound until it's infinitesimal. And when you do that, you find yourself almost like listening into the hollows of space. And something like that is the way you could relate to all separating aspects, but one like this with the intuition, where you're trying to reach something that is rarer and rarer and rarer. This isn't just a sudden moment. It is in the aftermath when things unwind. All right. It's a second sextile. And again, this is another redundancy. It is a synthetic sextile, meaning to say that things are synthesized into the spirit, in this case from the desire world and from the sensations of the physical world. So it is an abstraction from below to a higher level, and this is a third, and this the third redundancy makes it a really strong tendency in the horoscope. All right, this is taking awfully long, isn't it? I figured it would be only about an hour. So from all of this that we've looked at so far, we can see that we have a classic mystic. Someone who has let go of things. The Uranus Sun, especially in its separation and especially in the eighth house, is a letting go of things. But it's not letting go of things so that they fall apart. It's letting go of things so that things snap back into the spirit, so to speak. And we can see from all of this, even this aspect is between very gentle signs. Cancer and Virgo are both very gentle. The whole horoscope is someone who is forced to live a gentle and a harmless life. Now, when a person can do no harm, that's when a person is really ready for a higher life. And when they're ready to accept anything without preconception, that's somebody who's ready for a higher life. So in terms of individuality, this is clearly a mystic individual, whether the development is very far or not. It's somebody who is eager, but who realizes that she can't be restless or dissatisfied, because then she can't perceive anything. You know, she's always at the edge there. So in all of this, that we can see that she's sensitive to all of the different states and the higher kinds of feeling, as well as the lower states. So she is a self-responsible feeling person who is letting go of the world and just feeling. All right, we're down. Page and a quarter. So we've just seen that this Uranus aspect converges and mounts with everything else that we've said about her being a mystic. But Uranus has yet another aspect. And this aspect is similar to the Sun-Uranus aspect, but there are two differences. In this case, both are strong planets, but the aspect is weak. And the aspect is applying. Now, the Sun-Uranus, Uranus-Venus aspects are often aspects of spontaneous creativity, like in art, playing piano without lessons or anything like that. But that's not the case. But this is not a normal case. As we've said, she's not drawing on the spirit and changing the world. She's drawing on the world and feeding the spirit. So this is the second phase, synthetic. And that's again another case of drawing and reaching something higher. What she seems to be doing in this case is synthesizing human love. The Sun conjoined Venus showed her loving as a human being, a cheery human being. But the sextile of Venus to Uranus shows that she's taking that kind of love and raising it to a higher level. Now, if we look at this, Uranus and Venus are octaves. And so the Venusian love is giving itself over to the higher kind of love, the ecstatic kind of love, the kind of love that is associated with awe. Mystics are beings of love. And this is somebody who is capable of divine love. So what we're talking about with Uranus sextile Venus is that in the applying aspect is that she is building altruistic love. She's building Christ love. And she's synthesizing everything that is human into that which is higher. Now, she may not be doing this by reading scriptures and when you're told to do that, like in St. John's Gospel, but she's doing this through experience. This is in the living of her life, and that's what we're trying to get at. And so we can see from this that she is a mystic through and through and through. But that brings us to a very legitimate question. If she was so much of a mystic, why wasn't she capable of mystical things? And why wasn't she more bent toward mystical activities? She did remarkable things, and she did them with the feel of a mystic, but one certainly could not say that they were mystical activities. Some of them had a good deal of ingenuity, but they weren't like standard mysticism. She was severely handicapped, but her handicap was physical. And mystical activities don't depend on the physical ability. They depend on spiritual ability. So why wasn't she more accomplished as a mystic? Now, there are several answers to this. And one answer is standard. It's probably... you can't tell it from the horoscope. It's beyond astrological technique. But she probably didn't have sufficient soul power to do divine things. Or if she had it, it wasn't accessible to her. If you have the soul power, you know, you can develop all kinds of talents, but unless you have the soul power, which is the driving force behind them, they cannot be mystical or magical abilities. So she may have had the mystical nature, but maybe she has not had it long enough to have soul power, or maybe there is something else going on. And that brings up another answer. If you're following the mystical path, which is the path of emotion, feeling, and desire, there is a danger. There is a danger of being swept away by desire, especially sexual desire. The history of the path of mystics is filled with such cases. Like, take the very early Christian mystic named Saint Benedict, after whom the Pope has named himself. He tried to escape from sexuality. He was a very ardent praying man, but he tried to escape, and he went into a big pit in the ground where you had to go down a long ladder, and he was not going to be in touch with the world at all. He was going to live in this pit. I don't know whatever he did when it rained, but at any rate, he lived in this pit. He was going to, and what happened to him? Out of the ethers, women started appearing to him for sexual favors. So this is something that happens. There is even a phrase that is used to describe this. Such a person who's following the mystic path in this way is said to be highly sexed and highly spiritual. So we ask ourselves, was Helen Keller such a person? Was she somebody highly sexed that was swept away? And the answer is yes, without question. She's got Scorpio rising. Even until late in life, she wanted a marriage. And she wanted a marriage with full relations. And that she had to be restrained from entering into a questionable marriage in which the motives of both people were questionable. She can love, and she can love very well, and she improved in her ability to love throughout life, but love and sex are two very different things. And apparently, she lost that distinction. She got carried away by it. Pluto is ruled by Mars and Scorpio. They're both fixed signs, and they both have to do with power or actions for power. Sex flows from the realm of power. It is our basic creative power. So it seems likely that she got the power of sex in the past. Again, we have that 12th house, first house connection. And she perhaps even got into using it, which is likely if we look at Neptune, which is square to the sun, and in her spirituality, she has a history of using creative energy as she would. And so it's likely that in so doing, she got carried away. We talked about this when we talked about the reasons for blindness. We said that psychological cruelty, which is also associated with Mars and Neptune, and sexuality. This is perhaps someone who used her spiritual energies to satisfy herself sexually in a past life, and in a way was torturing others in enticement as well as torturing herself. So if there is any a lack of achievement in this life, it is probably because she got carried away by sex in the past and got off the mystic life. And so now she has to refound herself almost like a baby again. And that's what the feeling that you get with this kind of innocence in it. And that brings us to one last little snippet of the spirituality, which has to deal with Pluto. Pluto in this horoscope is in its detriment in Taurus. And usually when a planet is in its detriment, it is in a field of attitude where it is most disadvantaged, where it is most out of character, and often where it is weakened, or usually its weakest position. It's being asked to function in ways that it doesn't function well. What we're looking at when we're looking at Pluto is will, which is the function of divine spirit. And so will, in that sense, is the most subtle force that we as humans can work with. It is the force that appears to do nothing, while do everything while giving the appearance of doing nothing. Pluto's the godfather. Godfather, you don't see him out there wiping people out. The godfather just intends for something to be done and it is done. There's not often not even a communication. There is a tacit realization that this is what the Godfather wants. Taurus represents in the zodiac the deepest level of materialization, the most dense, the most solid, the most impenetrable of the whole zodiac. So like Pluto in Taurus is using the most subtle ability to try and break through something that is exceedingly dense, or to wield something that is exceedingly dense. It's sort of like trying to fracture a neutron star, or it's like trying to take a soda straw and poke it into granite or something like that. That's the image, at least that's the image I get with Pluto in Taurus. But as it radiates the field of Taurus, Pluto as will is unbudged, and it's unbudging. And it's in the seventh house, and it's conjoined to the descendant. And so it's as far west as it can get in the horoscope. And the farthest western point is when things are in the hands of others. And that is to say that the deepest controlling factor in the horoscope and in the life is in the hands of someone else. She is in someone else's power. And that person obviously was Annie Sullivan. Annie Sullivan was her life power, and the only life that she had because of Annie Sullivan, because everything that was given to her as experience was given by Annie Sullivan. Now, Mercury is square to Saturn, and it shows that many of the practical things in life are blocked. But the sextile Pluto to Mercury shows, well, let's look at the Saturn-Mercury square, shows that she was probably a conniver and blocked the minds of others in the past, but that's not really relevant here. I don't even know why I put it in the notes. The point is that she's being reformed, and she needs education, and that she needed somebody to control and expand her mind. Now, because of her circumstance, being in this dark silence with little or no input means that her mind had to be controlled in order to bring input to it. And it had to be patiently, powerfully, and unbudgingly controlled. And that is what came from the Pluto sextile to Mercury. We know that it was successful, or she wouldn't have gotten a college degree. She wouldn't have gotten all the education that she did. Now, when a person is being trained in initiation into the mysteries, the individual is taught to forget everything that they previously know, and to place all of their trust in the teacher. And the reason for this is that mystical knowledge is so different from material knowledge that we have in this existence that we're likely to get confused if we have if we try to apply worldly knowledge to mystical things. And that could be dangerous if you're in a critical stage of initiation and you're leading your body. From this, we can see that something analogous is happening in the life of Helen Keller. Now, for a mystic, one of the central things in the mystical path is obedience. And that obedience looks like it is being restored. Pluto is opposite that Scorpio ascendant, and that kind of obedience is being restored through the circumstances that she's put in. An even bigger thing in the path of a mystic is faith. And as we are looking at it, the negative pole of divine spirit, or the opposite side of the coin from will, is faith, an unbudging faith. For a definition of faith that's close to the to will, look at St. Paul's definition in the Bible. It's that faith that does nothing or seems to do nothing but yet accomplishes everything. So we can see that even this, her mental education is consistent with the life of a mystic. In terms of our inward experience, we make a mistake in that we think we are more in control of our lives than we really are. And we try self-consciously to control too much. Even with the higher self, we try to control too much. We try to do too much. But if we're quiet, and if we give our attention to something much deeper, to something very subtle in our being, we don't waste energy, but we get in touch. I don't know how to say, I can't say perceive, but we become at one with the intent of divine purpose. And something like that is happening in the spiritual consciousness of Helen Keller because of the mental circumstance that she has to go through with the teacher that controls her. So as a result, because I have in my own personal horoscope, I have Pluto trine to Mercury. And after going through this study, it has made me much stronger now on practicing giving attention and obedience to divine intention. And that's as much as I have for tonight.